Blessed be the name of the Lord, who loads us with his benefit, is gracious, is powerful, is able. To our God belongs the glory, the honor, and the power in Jesus' mighty name. Let's get to work from 2 Samuel chapter 11, verse 14 and verse 15. 2 Samuel 11, 14 to 15. Put Uriah in the front lines where the fighting is the fiercest. Then pull back and leave him exposed so that he is sure to be killed. But word again, out of 2 Samuel 11, 14, 15, put Uriah in the front lines where the fighting is the fiercest. Then pull back and leave him exposed so that he is sure to be killed. Spirit of the living God, as the word is heavy on me on the season, the time we're living in, make my tongue as a pen of a ready writer. Glorify your name yet again in my life. I pray today in Jesus' mighty name. Set free many. Help elevate. Bring to life that which is dead. Hopes, deliverance, trusts. Above all, the love of our God, the care of our God. Thank you, the Lord. I believe in your word. My spirit agrees and says a big amen. 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 Hallelujah. I want to use for a thought, do not pull back and leave me exposed. Let's say to one another, do not pull back and leave me exposed. One more time again, do not pull back and leave me exposed. On the day that this faithful soldier, a warrior, a battle general was to die, his name is Uriah. He received a letter sealed by his king to take to General Joab in the battlefield. Little did Uriah know that the letter he himself was taking was his death sentence. King David that morning wrote this letter and he said to Joab, please put Uriah in the front line, where the battle and the fighting is the fiercest. After that, pull back and leave him exposed. Pull back and leave him exposed that he might die. We're living in a time that we need to keep one another's back. But we need to trust the system. But we need to hear from God. We need to feel the pain of our neighbors, of one another, of our team members, of our family members. Uriah was a skilled warrior. But that day, he was to die. Uriah did not die because he could not handle the intensity of the battle. He did not die because he was not strong enough. He did not die because the enemy was mighty. Uriah died because of the negligence of those who were supposed to support him in the battle zone. His fellow soldiers sold him out. Those who were supposed to cover him exposed him for the enemy to devour him. The church is being tested, and the church possibly could be in one of the weakest knees at this time. Because for many things that are happening, we begin to accuse one another and not cover one another. When we hear a ministry, a minister that was mighty, is economically running down, people are left. Or a minister, servant of the Lord, whatever title that man or that woman holds, Is an ongoing challenge in their marriages. Is an ongoing challenge with their kids. Going challenge with their health. Instead of covering them up for prayer in prayers, we call one another and say, have you heard so and so is dying? Have you heard this? Have you heard this? Have you heard this? I came here to share with you today and encourage you. Do not pull back and leave me exposed. Don't pull back and leave me exposed. But what you need to do is to stand with me, is to pray with me. And I also came to secondly pledge my allegiance to the Lord God Almighty, that even when Jesus was being arrested and he needed his soldiers around with him and they were fleeing, we are saying we have learned a bitter lessons of our history enough. The time is here when we see a family under attack in Christianity. We see a ministry. We see a business. We see a marriage. We see the young kids that are not following the ways of the Lord. We don't need to pull back and leave them exposed, but we need to cover them up in prayer, in every supply that we can send, every way that we can send, everything that we can do good. We got to stand shoulder to shoulder, back to back, and not expose our family members. Lifeline from all over the world, even at this time of COVID, I want to say we will stand together. We are in this together. We will stand by supplying your needs, because Christ gives us the provision and gives us the courage and gives us the word in seasons. We know we may not be traveling all over the world to attend every barrio, but we send our beautiful thoughts, we send our prayer, we send every wish, and say together today, we have your back. We talk good about you, we talk good about your tribute, and whatever God is doing in your life, until we meet again, we will stand together, whether in heaven or on earth. We will cry together, we will laugh together at the celebrations and the party. But when time gets us tied together, we will say, God for us, and each one of us for each other. God will fight our battle. Give him praise and glory in the house of the Father. The true enemies of Uriah was not the enemy the Philistines fighting. The true enemies of Uriah were his battle soldier men, his servicemen, his troop men, his family men. Uriah was called by his own king to come visit his wife, because the king had an inner agenda. Knowing that he had raped this man's wife, she had conceived and wanted to seal it that this man came, and a child belongs to him. But God had another agenda. Yes, David was called and still called a man after God's own heart. But you need to understand something here. That God Almighty, pure as he is, true as he is, glorious as it is, he understands and forgives each one of us. We can be powerful men and women of God, but we still have a certain weakness somewhere. And that weakness doesn't mean you should expose us and make us to die. And that scheming plan of political parties and all the politicians, that the rhetoric that people speak here and there, the politicians and leaders speak, we may expose us, but one thing which is sure is that God will have a upper hand. The truth will prevail, that our God is fighting for us. Our God has our names in the book of life. Our God has our support and provision. Uriah was a man who did not need to die that day. It is another thing when you die because some enemies are against you. It is another thing when you die because other people who are supporting you are tired. But it is completely a different thing when you die because your leader is the one planning for your death. And I want to say sorry, and I want to apologize, and I want to say on behalf of other leaders around the world, Christianity should not be doing that. We are better than that. The blood was shed on Calvary for us. The Holy Ghost came for us. The fire will fall on Mount Carmel for us, because righteousness exalts a nation, and sin is a reproach to every nation, to the people of God. And I declare today, let it be known that we will stand on the the truth and righteousness. We will defend the truth of God. We will look at the people who are suffering in the communities. We will look at our church members and the other members of another denomination. And we will not expose you to leave you to die, because we have learned the bitter history of Christianity. We shall fight and overcome together. Give God praise and glory. Many, many, many of Christian leaders and Christian families have been tested positive with COVID-19. Many ministries, businesses are going down, are breaking off. Many marriages are not working. Children are at school no more. They've gone back home after parents have paid school fees. Our school terms and semesters have been messed up. But I'm saying, we will not expose one another so that they die. We'll stand together between the people and the porch and the Lord and the throne and the fire. And we put our hands ahead and say, Corona, this pandemic, pull back. We will withdraw you from the earth. We will melt you with the glory of God, with the power of the Holy Spirit. We will do everything that is necessary to be done. We will go every soul that we need to go. We will steam bath everything that we need to steam bath. But one more time, at the end of the day, oh yes, 1,000 shall fall on our left side and 10,000 shall fall to our right, because we, the believers, have made the Lord. Even the Most High, our shield, our buckler, Uganda, Africa, we stand together in the midst of the pandemic and we say, let God arise and his enemies be scattered. Let the praise of Adonai, let the blood of Jesus arise, and we will not die, and our generation will not be wiped away. Our children shall not be buried young. We will stand in the midst of the pandemic and declare, God is our shield and our refuge. Jesus, he is our shepherd. We shall not wander. Strong soldiers have died in the field because of negligence. Strong soldiers have been fatally wounded in the field because of indifference. And we're saying, in spite of every difference, we can be called different denominations. But Catholic and Anglicans, Baptists and Seventh-day and Lutherans and Orthodox, Pentecostals and Evangelicals, whatever you call us, we will stand together in the name of the Lord. We are called by the name of the Lord. We fight for each other. We talk good of each other until God Almighty pushes this pandemic out, until we emerge victorious, until the hot sun over us will be able to provide the vitamin D that we need, until the Pearl of Africa shall live again. Give God praise. This battle is not the end of the world. It's not the end of Christianity. It's not the end of our families. But we insist, don't pull back and leave us exposed. When we shift back in the time of trouble and the time of need, innocent and faithful people die physically, emotionally, economically, spiritually, because of us. When we shift back and become selfish and take care of our needs and cover our sins and cover our pride, the innocent are suffering and they're dying. When we pull back and expose our brethren, we become co-workers with the enemies of God. When our enemies keep watching and laughing at us, God will hold us accountable for neglecting our brothers and sisters in times of their need. Sometimes people leave the church because we pull back in their times of need, and thus they got exposed to the enemy. Let's be careful not to neglect one another, especially in the times of their need. The Bible tells us in Galatians chapter 6, verse number 2, bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. Bear one another's burden and so fulfill the laws of Christ. I am your Uriah. You are my Uriah. Let's not pull back and expose one another. I am strong when you are holding my back. You are strong when I have your back. Otherwise, on my own, I'm vulnerable. And as well as you are vulnerable when I am not holding your back. We stand together today and we want to say, in the mighty name of Jesus, church, let's stand with one another. Look for your brother. Look for your sister. The neighbor, the people in your neighborhood who are not doing well economically at this time of the COVID, who are not able to have enough food, who cannot send children to school or to attend to their medical needs. Let's help. Let's help and let's sound the alarm. Let's not die behind the battle alone. Exposed because no one cares. We do care. Lifeline, we do care. And if anyone says I don't, I want to say I do care. Because I want to stand together and not expose you so that you die. I'm reminded of a bit of story which I want to sign up with and read what I call the tears of Joseph. Say that with me. The tears of Joseph. One more time. The tears of Joseph. In Genesis 45, and I'm reading from line 14 to 28. It's longer than my tradition to read scriptures. It says, then Joseph fell on his brother Benjamin's neck and wept. And Benjamin wept on Joseph's neck. Moreover, Joseph kissed all his brothers and wept over them. And after that, his brothers talked with him. After he wept over them, his brothers talked with him. Now the report of it was heard in Pharaoh's house, saying, Joseph's brothers have come. So they pleased Pharaoh and his servants well. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, say to your brothers, do this. Load your camels and depart. Go to the land of Canaan. Bring your father and your households and come to me. I will give you the best of the land of Egypt. And you will eat the fat of the land. Oh yes, that verse 18 is worth repeating. I will give you the best of the land of Egypt. And you will eat the fat of the land. Verse 19, now, you are commanded, do this. Take cats out of the land of Egypt for your little ones and for your wives. Bring your father and come. Also, do not be concerned about your goods, for the best of all the land of Egypt is yours. Then the sons of Israel did so, and Joseph gave them cats according to the command of Pharaoh. And he gave them provisions for the journey. He gave to all of them, to each man, changes of garments. But to Benjamin, he gave 300 pieces of silver and 5 changes of garments. And he sent to his father these things. 10 donkeys loaded with the good things of Egypt. And 10 female donkeys loaded with grain, food, meat for his father for the journey. So he sent his brothers away, and they departed, and he said to them, see that you do not become troubled along the way. Then they went up out of Egypt and came to the land of Canaan to Jacob, their father. And they told Jacob, saying, Joseph is still alive, and he is governor over all the land of Egypt. And Jacob's heart stood still because he did not believe them. But when they told him all the words which Joseph had said to them, and when he saw the cats which Joseph had sent to carry him, the spirit of Jacob, their father, revived. Then Israel said, it is enough. Joseph, my son, he is still alive. I will go see him before I die. In Genesis 37, He had a dream. The moon, the sun bowed to him. Genesis 39, he had a dream. The 11 stars bowed to him. The story continues that these 11 stars were his brothers, whose the father, Jacob, Israel, sent Joseph to follow them and supply their needs of food while taking care of the flocks. The flocks, they saw him from afar and say, here comes the dreamer. Let's expose him that he might die. They took the colors, the coats of many colors from him, threw him to the pit. He did not die. They watched to see him cry. He did not cry. They sold him away to the Midianites as a slave. Joseph did not cry. When he was being auctioned like a piece of a metal or a goat, he did not cry. When he was serving in the house of Potiphar, Joseph did not cry. When Potiphar's wife accused him falsely, he did not cry. When Joseph was thrown into prison for a crime he did not commit, a strong Joseph did not cry. When he was rotting there, forgotten by the baker and the butler, Joseph did not cry. When he came out from the prison to the palace, he did not cry. The first, the second time, when he saw his brothers, he did not cry. Joseph, when he had all opportunity, all the power, and right now on his side, because the period it was the underdog being sold away, they were supposed to have killed him. He did not fight back. But now he is the leader of this most powerful nation in the world. Now he could take revenge and kill them. Now he could deny them food supplies. Now he could tell the soldiers, put them in prison. Now he had all the power to destroy them. He did not destroy them. But instead, Joseph took up the courage of love, took up his better side, and he wept for the tears of joy. My brother, my sister, oh yes, family, a time is coming. We will not remember the bitterness and the pain and all the mistreatment that we receive in ministry, we receive during the pandemic, but we will remember the goodness of our God to deliver us through the battle, to deliver us through the famine, to deliver us through all the times of the pandemic, to deliver us when we should have died of all the health healed. And when we are together and when we are victorious, we will not remember which president did not do what. We will not remember what Ministry of Health did not do what. We will not remember what LCs and what driver did not do what. We will remember that here we have arrived. We are alive again. We are smiling again. We are better again. We will do that to the glory of God our Father. Give him praise and glory and honor. On March the 4th, 1861, United States of America was in the midst of a serious civil war. A new president, Abraham Lincoln, had just been elected. On that fateful day, March 4th, 1861, Abraham Lincoln stood to give his inaugural address. And in part, I will quote this. That we will remember the blood of our brothers gushing out in the battlefront. We'll remember the bitterness, the pain, the enmity that divided us. But most importantly, we'll forget about all those painful past. Because we will stand together as one nation. Because we are guided by our better angel. Because that's our nature. And I'm saying here today, may we be guided by our better angel, not our guardian angel. Our guardian angel is outside us, but our better angel is inside us. It's coming from our heart. It's coming from our belly. Our better angel is the part of our nature. Our better evangel is the forgiveness, is the mercy, is the grace, is the gratitude that we can still think good things about God. The gratitude that we can still think good things about our children, about our parents, about our government, about our society. The good things about Africa. And we are saying today, in the mighty name of Jesus, may we be guided by our better angels, so that we don't condemn the people who fail to supply our needs. We don't condemn the people who point accusing fingers on us. We don't condemn and fight the other family who say this and say that. But we will be guided by our better angel and stand together as the family of Lifeline, and stand together as the body of Christ, and stand together as the people of God, and stand together in righteousness, and supply one another's need, and talk good, and hug one another, and sweat together. That time when the SOPs will not need to be kept because Corona will be history. The time when the fellowship of the brethren is warmer. The time when we can give the high five. The time we can give the holy hug and the holy kiss. And nobody will accuse us, even the people whom we don't know, who have written the SOPs. The time when the body of Christ shall come back again to Mount Zion and sing with joy, with everlasting song, with our redemption drawing nigh. Look up, O body of Christ. Look up, O soldiers of Jesus Christ. Your redemption draws nigh. Do not pull back and leave me exposed to be killed, because we are standing in this together. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Come on, give him praise, glory, and honor. I say, give him praise, glory, and honor. Hallelujah. Don't pull back and leave me exposed. I pray, Father, in Jesus' name, for the families that are battling under COVID-19, economic strains, health issues, no school fees, no rent, this and the other. God, even our God, you will supply our needs supernaturally, according to your power, in Christ Jesus in glory. We praise your name that you are a shepherd we shall not want. We praise your name, you are our Rapha. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. I command your lungs to bless the Lord. I command your respiratory system to bless the Lord. I command your heart and your kidneys to bless the Lord. I command your pancreas to bless the Lord. I command your neck to bless the Lord. Your legs to bless the Lord. Bless the Lord and all that is within you. You will not forget the Lord's benefit, the Lord's glory, and the Lord's provision, in the mighty name of Jesus. We promise we will not leave you exposed, that you will die in the corona. We stand together. We yoke together. We fellowship together. And no one will tell us to disobey Hebrews 10:25. Do not forget the meeting together of brethren, even as we see the day growing evil. This is not the time of isolation. This is the time to socially stand together. Physical isolation is not spiritual isolation. Physical isolation is not lack of joining and agreeing together. Where two or three agree together, God is there. Let's agree through the airwaves such as this and blast this COVID-19, stupid 19, out of Africa, and believe together that in the name of Jesus, our help may not come from our government, our help may not come from injection and vaccination, our help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and the earth. Thank God, Jesus is alive and well. We thank you, we bless you, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen, and amen, and amen. Give God praise and glory again.